Assert Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents The CISO CISO Evolution, Business Knowledge for Cybersecurity Executives, by Matthew K. Sharp and Kyriakos Lambros. Narrated by Christopher Grove. Publisher's note: in this audio edition, you will hear references to visual elements present in the print and ebook formats of the book. Foreword. Welcome to an incredible period of change in cybersecurity. What an amazing time to be in this field. In the chapters that follow, two of the industry's leading critical thinkers divulge the skills and knowledge a cybersecurity leader must acquire to successfully build a modern-day cybersecurity program. To get the job done, they combine personal stories, practical knowledge, and intimate case studies. My colleagues, Rock Lambros and Matthew Sharp, will challenge us to think about cybersecurity on a new level. They encourage us to contemplate managing our cybersecurity programs differently, through a business lens. What's more, they offer us the tools to make that transition a reality. With 40 years combined industry experience across many verticals, I'm confident you'll find this book rich with key insights about building, sustaining, and maintaining your cybersecurity program. I can't think of two more qualified practitioners to lead the charge in shaping how we must evolve our approach to aligning cybersecurity programs with business objectives. Rock and Matt offer profound insights into how organizations should design, adapt, and embrace cybersecurity best practices to ensure business alignment. Gone are the days of selling your security program through fear, uncertainty, or doubt. FUD. The era of digital business will require executive presence to claim your seat at the table. The success that has brought you to your current role is a good start. I'd like to disrupt your assumptions and inspire a deliberate review of what you need to survive in the middle of the cybersecurity jungle. I would encourage you to consult this timeless, universally applicable reference in your journey forward. The CISO Evolution, Business Knowledge for Cybersecurity Executives, is not only your survival guide, it's a blueprint for the aspiring cybersecurity leaders of tomorrow. The concepts in this book are proven through multiple industries. As life learners, Rock and Matt hope to ignite a spark in you. Meanwhile, their courage, coupled with their commitment to give back to our community, was the driving force that led to this seminal work. The only constant with our field is change, and the rate of change continues to intensify. If you think you've seen it all so far, I'm here to tell you, we've not seen anything yet. The future holds boundless uncertainty. How do we stay current? More importantly, how do we embrace this change while ensuring alignment with the business? The answer is the CISO Evolution, Business Knowledge for Cybersecurity Executives. As you read this book, please keep in mind that most businesses are trying to move at the speed of innovation. We need something radically different. Rock and Matt are the industry experts prying open a new door to an unexplored path that will make us think differently about our cybersecurity programs. Dimitrios Lazarikos, Laz, 3-time CISO, 30-plus year security veteran, business and technical advisor, co-founder, Blue Lava. Preface. To know and not to do is really not to know. Stephen R. Covey. Go to enough conferences and a clear pattern emerges. A few industry leaders have the courage and presence to impart wisdom. Yet most of the industry is an echo chamber of platitudes. Maybe you've heard a hollow statement from a so-called expert. These throwaway phrases reveal nothing. Yet our colleagues masquerade behind them as thought leaders. The most insipid example, speak to the business in business terms. For too long, we have allowed one another to nod in agreement, while behind the scenes we consistently fail to apply this wisdom and execute. This book provides a roadmap so that you can start asking the right questions, making the right investments, and delivering outcomes that matter. The first generation of CISOs learned that with confidence you can cast cybersecurity as a black art that cannot be measured. Eventually, the anecdotes and hopeful statements weren't enough. Business leaders soon learned that cybersecurity knowledge is only part of the job. So we have arrived at an inflection point. We can do better. We must do better. It's time to evolve. The challenges of information sharing in our field are known, along with a talent crunch. To cultivate the future leaders of our profession, we must exhibit the courage to be vulnerable as people. Cryptocurrencies, IoT, and the public cloud will accelerate the demand for safe computing. Future economies will rise in cyberspace. The wars of the information age will be fought and won digitally. Competition is no longer about company versus company. Instead, bundles of services and the most effective supply chains dictate the winners and losers of commerce. Courage is the path forward. It won't be easy. It will require that we circumnavigate the legal constraints, licensing restrictions, fear, and self-preservation that has prevented the requisite knowledge sharing and talent development. We fought back each of these dragons in the process of publishing this book. With the stakes higher than they have ever been, Rock and I hope to share our experiences as builders, operators, and consultants. We are both experienced CISOs and MBA graduates. We have supported leaders who failed to convince their businesses of the importance of cybersecurity risk. We have lived these symptoms. Failure to garner trust from executive leadership. Misaligned expectations around risk appetite and capital allocation. Misperception of cybersecurity's role in business. Demoralization of your team in the face of cyber risk acceptance. Increased stress and anxiety from managing an underfunded program. As authors, we see the world through different lenses. We disagree in our politics, our management styles are varied, and we think this phase shift in values and approach will benefit you as the reader. Path dependence is when the decisions presented to people are dependent on historical experiences. So we complement each other in the diversity of our experiences and the order of our career transitions. Rock was an operator for years before starting his own consultancy. In contrast, I spent years in consulting before I was entrusted with the responsibility of operating a security program. Indeed, the world looks different from the vantage of a vendor versus that of an end user. You are treated differently, welcomed or not into circles of peers, and so the lessons you learn, the relationships you build, and soft skills you hone are a product of your path dependence. With this book, we created a streamlined business reference that is tailored to cybersecurity professionals. It will equip you with the insights curated to develop your business acumen, communication, and leadership skills. The chapters expand upon the content often delivered in MBA programs. Each of these capabilities is required by the modern CISO. We provide you with the tools you need to evolve from a technical leader into an effective cybersecurity executive. Each chapter is packed full of specific, practical advice and real-life stories to help you communicate with business leaders, establish an executive presence, secure cybersecurity budgets, protect what matters, and not only enable, but also accelerate business outcomes. By contributing our mistakes and experience, we hope to fuel your success and stimulate more forthright dialogue in our industry. If you find value in this book, we'd love to hear from you. And if you disagree, take issue, or find room for us to improve, we'd love to hear from you too. You can find us at cisoevolution.com. That's all uppercase C-I-S-O-E, lowercase V-O-L-U-T-I-O-N.com. or on LinkedIn, Matthew K. Sharp, all lowercase, linkedin.com/in/CISO-MBA/. Kyriakos Rock Lambros, all lowercase, linkedin.com/in/Rock Lambros, or all lowercase, rocklambros/. Introduction. In the foreword and preface, we got aligned on the challenges our industry faces, our motivations for writing the book, and a bit about the authors. To help you use this book as reference in your day-to-day experience, we'll now review the structure of the book and offer a summary of each chapter. First, note that the book has three parts. So if you plan to read the book front to back, the flow is natural and the content is cumulative. Chapters at the back of the book assume you are capable of financial analysis, business cases, and other topics covered early on. In our view, it was important to first establish requisite foundational business knowledge in Part 1. That is where you will learn key vocabulary, basic financial formulas, and business strategy tools. We will also review business decision models, valuation methodologies, and business case development. Each chapter, or class, includes one or more case studies to apply the knowledge you've learned. That's true throughout the book, and also true in any MBA program as well. What is different here is that our case studies are developed through the lens of the CISO, rather than a strict business perspective that surfaces in MBA curricula. Equipped with a common foundation of business knowledge and clear examples of how to apply the core concepts, we move on to Part 2, Communication and Education. Here you can expect a review of how to leverage COSO, an enterprise risk management framework, to ensure cybersecurity risk fits into the broader context of business risk management. Remember, cybersecurity risk is another risk that needs to be addressed along with financial, operational, strategic, legal, and compliance risk. Just as market, credit, and liquidity risks are types of financial risk, there are subcategories of cyber risk too. So Part 2 is the connective tissue that ensures cybersecurity risk is properly framed and prioritized. Finally, assuming a foundation of business concepts and the proper governance structures for treating cybersecurity risks are in place, you need to lead a team and execute according to the priorities you have established and the projects you have funded. In Part 3, Cybersecurity Leadership, we review techniques for attracting and retaining talent, and finally, negotiation skills that will help you navigate interactions with your employees, colleagues, investors, regulators, and outside vendors. Now that you know how the book is structured, it's also important to understand how the chapters are structured throughout the book. Through personal stories, we outline the opportunities we feel are most relevant at the very beginning of each chapter. Then we introduce theory or research in the principle section. Next, each chapter extends theory with an application section that features one or more illustrative case studies. In some cases, the names or details were adapted to protect the innocent. Finally, each chapter is summarized with a key insights section that draws out the salient lessons we hope you learn. There is also a notes section provided at the end of each chapter that outlines supporting research and reference materials. We recommend that before you read a chapter, you read the key insights and examine the table of contents. Since we cover many high-level frameworks quickly, this approach will be helpful to keep you oriented in the chapter and book. It's also a speed reading technique. The following paragraphs provide a summary of each chapter. Part 1. Foundational Business Knowledge. Chapter 1. Financial Principles. This chapter builds your knowledge of financial statements, reviews connections between each statement, offers free resources for further study, and features two case studies that relate cybersecurity operations to accounting rules and financial statements. Read this chapter to solidify your understanding of EBITDA, CAPEX, OPEX, retained earnings, and net income, along with other fundamental vocabulary and accounting concepts. Chapter 2. Business Strategy Tools. In the second chapter, we introduce business models, KPIs, and value chains. Other topics include board composition and systems theory. We provide a case study to demonstrate the use of the business model canvas. There are two additional case studies that feature value chain linkages to create competitive advantage. One case study features optimization, while the second focuses on coordination. Read this chapter for tools that will help you dissect your business's strategy, understand the supply and demand dynamics of your company operations, connect to primary business measures, and optimally position cybersecurity as a source of competitive advantage. Chapter 3. Business Decisions. Our third chapter explores how business decisions are made. Decision-making can be improved with an awareness of the biases and noise that commonly afflict us as human beings. We cover a lightweight application of the scientific method to enhance learning. From there, we dive into decision science and choice architecture frameworks. We briefly examine the use of an influence model, and then we finish the chapter with two case studies. The first case study examines various applications of the decision science framework in the context of a hypothetical new CISO scenario. In the second case study, we apply choice architecture to phishing defense. Chapter 4. Value Creation. The fourth chapter is all about business valuation. We naturally start by defining what we mean by value. Then we examine the critical attributes of value. Next, we explore how those attributes surface in determining business valuations. Additionally, we examine investor types, means of return, valuation methodologies, and common value drivers. The application section covers the core concepts in a case study that applies security strategy in the context of business valuation for a hypothetical beverage manufacturer. Chapter 5. Articulating the business case. To get the fifth chapter started, we review several important cost concepts, including incremental, opportunity, and sunk cost. From there, we explore communication framework and two financial analysis methods, cost-benefit analysis and net present value. Finally, we close out the chapter with three case studies. The first examines a successful budget request for password management, and the second applies cost-benefit analysis to the same project. The final case study leverages a Monte Carlo simulation to examine possible net present value outcomes of a revenue-generating opportunity resulting from delivery of security services. Part 2. Communication and Education. Chapter 6. Cybersecurity, a Concern of the Business, Not Just IT. In Part 2, we build upon Part 1 and introduce additional tools that transform cyber risk issues into enterprise risk dialogue. This chapter starts to break down the COSO framework. It lays the foundation for elevating cyber risk conversations to enterprise risk by focusing on the first two guiding principles of COSO: governance and culture, strategy and objective setting. At the end of this chapter, the case study relives one of the author's greatest regrets and warns of the consequences of failing to establish a robust governance structure. Chapter 7. Translating Cyber Risk into Business Risk. Chapter 6 discussed establishing a cyber risk management program's foundation using COSO's first two guiding principles. This chapter expands upon those foundations and focuses on executing the cyber risk program and rolling up cyber risk into a portfolio view of enterprise risk that executive leaders and the board can use to make business decisions. To do this, we will align with the final three risk management components of COSO: performance, review and revision, information, communication, and reporting. The case study reveals how the author helped an organization align its cybersecurity program to its enterprise risk management efforts. This ultimately highlighted previously unknown risks and secured additional funding from its board of directors. Chapter 8. Communication. You do it every day, or do you? This chapter challenges you to examine how you communicate. It provides a structure to improve communication for the explicit purpose of advancing a cybersecurity program. We close this chapter by expanding upon the case study in Chapter 7. We take you into the boardroom to eavesdrop on the conversation between the author and the board of directors. Part 3. Cybersecurity Leadership. Chapter 9. Relationship Management. You cannot operate in a vacuum. A robust cybersecurity program relies on individual technical skills and interpersonal relationships. Read this chapter to master the four key skills of relationship management: maintaining trust, indirect influence, managing through conflict, and professional networking. We conclude with two case studies. The first demonstrates how some humble pie is the remedy to establishing greater trust. The second case study shows the importance of a professional network as the author transitioned from being an operator to an entrepreneur. Chapter 10. Recruiting and Leading High-Performing Teams. The cybersecurity skills gap is well documented, yet hotly debated. However, as a leader, you must ensure you have the right people in the right roles at the right time. This chapter will dive into methodologies we utilized to attract, retain, and lead high-performing teams. The case study walks through the perils of combining a bureaucratic hiring process with an inability to implement the hiring practices we advocate for in this chapter. The same case study then walks through what it was like to get baptized by fire in servant leadership. Chapter 11. Managing Human Capital. Read this chapter for specific tools to baseline strengths, critical considerations in managing a multi-generational workforce, the importance of training, the criticality of diversity, and cognitive biases to be aware of that may rear themselves in our day-to-day jobs. The case study brings to bear a cost-benefit analysis technique outlined in Chapter 5 to demonstrate the actual value of training and the true cost of eliminating it from a constrained budget. Chapter 12. Negotiation. In this penultimate chapter, we focus on adapting the skills from Chris Voss, a former FBI hostage negotiator, as featured in his book Never Split the Difference: Negotiating as If Your Life Depended on It. There are countless negotiations you perform every day. If you can be successful in your negotiations while preserving your relationships, you have what it takes to generate cultural change. The chapter concludes with a case study on building security culture and application security using the negotiation techniques introduced. Conclusion. We conclude the book with a heartfelt note of gratitude and an optimistic eye toward a brighter future. Engage us online at cisoevolution.com. That's all uppercase CISOE, all lowercase VOLUTION.com. Part 1. Foundational Business Knowledge. Chapter 1. Financial Principles. Embrace Reality and Deal with It. Ray Dalio. Opportunity. It's easy to get distracted by how you think things should be, yet it is critical to understand how they really are. Early in my career, I often identified ways that would make my work more efficient. When there was a dependency on resources I didn't have, I usually stewed in frustration about how stupid the people were who designed such a flawed system in the first place. It wasn't until years later that I learned optimizing all parts of a system does not necessarily optimize the system itself. You see, every organization has a mission and limited resources. Today, nearly all organizations in the modern economy deliver value through technology. However, not all organizations and leaders agree upon the importance of cybersecurity. As a cybersecurity leader, it's your job to educate, build consensus, and secure necessary resources. Organizational mission and cybersecurity goals must be aligned. I think Malcolm Harkins said it best. We provide protection that enables information to flow through the organization, our partners, and our customers. We protect the technology that our organizations create to provide new experiences and opportunities for our customers. Now, imagine for a moment you are on vacation and you've decided to travel internationally. The country you're visiting speaks another language. You've done your part to learn a few key words before your arrival, so you have the basic vocabulary. You can count to 10, you can ask about the time, and you know different words that indicate modes of transportation. There you sit in the terminal at the bus station, and the time comes for your bus to leave. You make your way to the platform and discover no bus. Of course, you don't know if you missed the bus, if it is late, or if they simply changed the platform. When you turn to ask a passerby, they don't speak your language. You go back to the information desk and ask for help. The attendant offers hints at what to do through gestures, but you remain a bit uncertain. The attendant tells you what you can only make out to mean, "The bus will come 8. What does that mean? Bus number 8? Platform 8? At 8 p.m.? In 8 minutes? There's no way to be sure because neither of you possesses adequate language. It is precisely this experience that happens worldwide as companies decide how much they should invest in cybersecurity. Without a foundational understanding of accounting and financial principles, you are unlikely to succeed in securing the appropriate resources required so that you may effectively protect and enable your organization. What is also true is that business leaders speak the language of business. They are dependent upon you to communicate about your topic of expertise, cybersecurity, in a language they can understand. This concept isn't new, and we've been hearing about it for several decades now. You'll encounter the phrase, "speak in business language," in professional journals and conferences alike. Yet, there seems to be very little information available to outline the critical vocabulary and concepts that cybersecurity practitioners need to secure their seat at the table. Principle. The focus of this first chapter is to establish critical vocabulary and fundamental business knowledge. We will briefly overview several terms only to the extent required to understand their application. Naturally, these terms have been covered in detail elsewhere. When possible, we will point to our favorite resources. These resources emphasize cheap or free, easy to consume, and available in a convenient form. That should help you dig into various topics that pique your interest or prove weak points in your knowledge base. We think you'll pick up a few of the most valuable nuggets right here in this very first chapter. So resist your temptation to skip forward. To get you started, I'll share the approach I used to structure my pursuit of business acumen. At the time, I was a consultant, and a high percentage of my work weeks included commuting by plane to a customer site. That's where I learned about Josh Kaufman's The Personal MBA, all lowercase personalmba.com/, which touts a world-class business education in a single volume. Since I am perhaps the slowest reader in the world, I decided to expedite my knowledge acquisition by leveraging getabstract.com/, which, as of this writing, claims to contain the key insights of 20,000-plus nonfiction books summarized into compelling 10-minute reads. These were a great start, but ultimately I obtained an MBA because I wasn't confident that my cursory review was sufficient. We hope this book can be an alternative, serving as a shortcut to the long nights and imbalance that a master's degree can impose on your personal life. Conceptually, there are relatively few things you need to master from this chapter. you need to know a handful of vocabulary words, how to read and understand financial statements, and how to apply them to your role as a cybersecurity leader. The good news is, that's it, from an accounting and finance perspective. It is worth mentioning that later in the book, we'll continue to infuse these foundational business concepts with other topics intended to develop more complete business acumen, including Part 2, Communication and Education, and Part 3, Cybersecurity Leadership. So let's dive in with our first topic. Financial statements. There are three financial statements. The income statement offers a window into profit performance on a specific date. The balance sheet describes the financial position comprised of assets, liabilities, and equity at a particular point in time. And finally, the statement of cash flow describes what cash came into the business and what went out in a given period, typically a quarter or a year. Income statement. As with any complex topic, it can be helpful to start at a very high level and then pursue a more nuanced understanding. To get started, we're going to review the critical elements of an income statement. Revenue. Cost of goods sold, COGS, / cost of revenue. Gross profit, GP. Sales, general and administrative expenses, SG&A. Earnings before interest, taxes, depreciation, and amortization, EBITDA. Depreciation expense. Amortization expense. Earnings before interest and taxes, EBIT. Interest expense. Income tax expense. Net income. Bottom line. The order of each item conveys a story. A few items appear in gray. They are not required and therefore may not be present in all income statements. However, you can always calculate them from the information available. The elements in gray often serve as metrics that have a significant influence on behaviors in business. Let's cover each of the items and reveal the story they tell. Revenue. First, we start with revenue, which can often be called the top line. Revenue is essentially the amount of money that the company received for the sale of its product or services. Without revenue, you can't pay for any of the expenses that follow. So this is a great place to start. Some companies focus on net revenue. You can calculate it by subtracting discounts, returns, and allowances from revenue. Depending upon your business model and perhaps the economic sector, there are often compelling arguments that a cybersecurity leader can make about how their team contributes to enhancing revenue acquisition. Accelerating revenue is especially true for software or SaaS or SaaS companies serving highly regulated industries, as their customers undoubtedly have significant compliance obligations. One good indicator is if your cybersecurity team is helping sales complete diligence questionnaires for your customers and prospects. If so, then you are certainly part of the sales cycle and serve as an advocate of revenue acquisition. Third-party risk management, TPRM, is undoubtedly a complicated endeavor that may seem duplicative and at times even unproductive. Do not fall prey to the trap. Instead, embrace your role here. More sales activity means more revenue to fund operations, including cybersecurity operations. TPRM also gives you a view into revenue sources, what types of customers you will soon serve, and what value expectations exist. These insights can help you anticipate demands on other areas of your security program. Cost of goods sold / cost of revenue. Next, we see the term COGS, which only makes sense in a company that produces a physical product. In a service or software business, you are more likely to see the term cost of revenue. It means the same thing, but the terminology is a bit different. There are all kinds of nuanced language with financial statements that mostly get us to the same outcome. Start with what your customers paid you. Subtract the costs and determine what remains for retained earnings, future investment, or dividends. Suffice it to say that there are generally accepted accounting principles that specify what expenses you must group and where they must appear in the financial statements. COGS/cost of revenue includes raw materials, shipping costs, sales commission, and direct labor costs. If your business is not primarily in the delivery of cybersecurity services or software, you probably don't have a role to play in this line item. However, you may be able to augment funding sources or support the cybersecurity program by partnering with other business stakeholders with a heavy COGS expense concentration. It may be easier to obtain security champions in other teams that perhaps establish a dotted line reporting structure. Partnering in this way can be a great source of operational leverage by ensuring more consistent security outcomes but requiring less of your direct managerial attention. Gross profit. Gross profit, GP, is the profit a company makes after removing the costs associated with manufacturing and selling its products or delivering its services. You calculate GP by subtracting the COGS from revenue. Gross profit equals revenue minus COGS. Note that gross margin is a commonly used and very similar term. Frequently, people incorrectly use it interchangeably with GP. In short, gross margin is a percentage value, while GP is a monetary value. They both represent the resources available to invest in your business and accelerate growth after you have directly delivered upon your commitment to your customers. To calculate gross margin, gross margin equals, open parentheses, net revenue minus COGS, close parentheses, divided by net revenue. Margin profile can be a value gate in deriving a company's worth. That is to say, some business models anticipate a high gross margin, SaaS professional services, etc., while others will not, such as an electronic components distributor, value-added reseller, airline, etc. Either way, you want to be clear on gross margin expectations. Ask your financial planning and analysis, FP&A team, if you don't already know. Sales, general, and administrative expenses. Some costs can be difficult, if not impossible, to assign to specific revenue-generating activities directly. These are things like rent, phone, utilities, and salaries for shared services such as legal, IT, and cybersecurity. They all frequently fall into the category of sales, general, and administrative SG&A expenses. And this is why cybersecurity is often a cost center. For now, just know that no enterprise cost reduction or transformation effort is complete without some consideration of SG&A expenses. Note that SG&A may also appear under the title operating expenses. EBITDA or EBITDA. One way to calculate earnings before interest, taxes, depreciation, and amortization, EBITDA, is by building up from the bottom of the income statement. Starting with net income, we'll add each item to derive our final value, or we can start with a top line and subtract. EBITDA equals net income plus interest plus taxes plus depreciation plus amortization, or EBITDA equals net revenue minus cost of goods sold, COGS, minus operating expenses plus depreciation plus amortization. We'll go into business valuation in much more detail in Chapter 4, Value Creation. For now, it's essential to know that using an EBITDA multiple is one of the most common methods for valuing a company. EBITDA is particularly useful to investors as it provides a more transparent view of financial results. Unfortunately, accounting methods selected, for depreciation in particular, can enhance profits artificially. Using EBITDA helps expose the underlying cash-generating profile of the business. In any given year, there are one-time expenses that may impact EBITDA. The goal is not to make you an expert in calculating EBITDA. Leave that to your accounting and finance departments. Instead, the purpose of reviewing the formulas is to offer you an awareness of the relationship each of the income statement line items has with the metrics your company executives care about most. Depreciation and amortization. In the course of operating a business, assets wear down or become obsolete. Obsolescence applies to both tangible and intangible assets. For example, servers may break down over time, and a company can only legally enforce intellectual property rights, such as patents, for a limited number of years. Because assets have useful lives that frequently last longer than one accounting period, accountants reduce the value of these assets over their estimated service lives. The term depreciation applies when the asset is tangible, such as furniture or computers. Similarly, accountants use amortization when an asset is intangible. EBIT or EBIT. Earnings before interest and taxes, EBIT, is similar to EBITDA. In this case, we pull the depreciation and amortization expenses back into the picture. Operating profit considers the capital expenditures that span more than one accounting period and reflect the profit or loss resulting from operations more accurately. Investors examine operating profit to separate a company's operational performance from the costs of the capital structure and tax expenses. EBIT equals net income plus interest plus taxes, or EBIT equals net revenue minus cost of goods sold, COGS, minus operating expenses. Interest expense. Interest expense reflects the payable liability resulting from any borrowing management has done to fund operations. It is often evaluated outside the operational analysis and is called a non-operating expense. Interest expense includes loans, lines of credit, bonds, and any type of convertible debt. There is often very little that cybersecurity teams can do to affect the interest expense. Income tax expense. The government collects taxes to finance public services or national programs. One source of funding that contributes to these services is income tax. So a tax expense is a liability owed to the government. Again, cybersecurity teams cannot impact the tax expense materially. Net income. Net income is what you have left after you have subtracted away everything you spent. For that reason, it's also known as the bottom line. As you will see, net income connects to retained earnings, which is the cash a company keeps to finance further operations. The relationship becomes much more apparent in the connections between the financial statements section later in this chapter. If by this point you are feeling pretty good, then by all means keep reading. If you're feeling a little uncertain or unsettled about your mastery of the materials, spend some time settling in with these concepts. Here are several great resources to help you close the knowledge gap. All lowercase, responsive.net. /initialcapaccounting.alllowercase.skills.html. alllowercaseaccountingcoach.com/. alllowercaseaccountingexplained.com/financial/introduction/. Balance sheet. A balance sheet offers a view into the capital structure or how an organization finances its assets through a combination of debt and equity. A simple formula summarizes the information contained on the balance sheet. Assets equals liabilities plus equity. The financial condition includes ensuring that the company has enough cash and controlling liabilities relative to assets and revenues. The financial state is primarily a chief financial officer, CFO, responsibility. One standard financial ratio on the balance sheet is the debt-to-equity DE ratio. A heavily leveraged company will have a relatively high DE ratio, meaning the company has borrowed a lot to finance operations. Typically, analysts compare a DE ratio of one company to another company competing in the same or similar industry. That is to say, comparing the debt-to-equity DE ratio of a high-growth SaaS technology company to an energy company wouldn't be an informative analysis. The risk profile, stability of revenue, equipment required to operate, and borrowing costs will be very different given the risk to lenders for each of these very different business models. In my experience, the only time I ever considered any of these balance sheet topics was in deciding to take the job or not. Even then, the issue surfaced indirectly via a line of questioning. Do I have a budget? How is it funded? What control do I have over it? While a balance sheet is essential to company managers, it is not typically a driving force in conversations outside of one key element that appears indirectly on the balance sheet: capital expenditures. Capital expenditures. Capital expenditures, CapEx, are expenses that a company capitalizes. That means it records expenses on its balance sheet as an investment rather than on its income statement as an expenditure. This process was touched upon briefly in the depreciation and amortization section. Again, for clarity, assets have useful lives that last longer than a given accounting period, so accountants reduce the value of these assets over their estimated service lives. This value appears as a depreciation or amortization expense, which is a fraction of the actual cost in most cases. CapEx becomes particularly crucial in a business where enterprise value, EV, or what the company is worth to investors, is determined by an EBITDA multiple. Notice that EBITDA, the value driver of the business, does not include depreciation and amortization expense. In some cases, CapEx may include capitalized labor associated with the development of intangible assets, such as software, intellectual property, and patents. There are several cybersecurity activities in the new cloud era you can consider capitalizing. Additionally, consider the productive asset investment ratio, PAIR. If capital expenditures exceed annual depreciation, the business is likely expanding as more fixed assets are added that have depreciated over the same time. This ratio can be a clear indicator of a company's willingness to maintain its current level of investment. If the value is below 1.0, the business may have accounting or operational challenges. Companies with a value greater than 1.0 have more valuable earnings because they aren't delaying capital expenditures to boost their profits. Statement of cash flows. Cash flow statements show the change in cash over the accounting period. Cash flow statements are structured to demonstrate how the cash balance was affected by operating, investing, and financing activities. Operating activities may include selling, collecting payments and interest, building or purchasing inventory, paying salaries, and contracting third-party suppliers and service providers. Investing may comprise buying and selling non-current assets, typically termed property, plant, and equipment, PPE. Finally, financing activities include paying down debts, issuing equity and dividends, borrowing funds, and even repurchasing stock. There is value in clarifying. The statement of cash flow tells you nothing of profit. That is to say, your cash balance can, and often does, go down during profitable growth. Also, it is equally probable for cash to increase while a business operates in the red, unprofitably. The relationship between cash and profit is perhaps one of the most common points of confusion. At the heart of the difficulty is accrual accounting. Accrual accounting matches revenue and expenses at the time of a transaction, rather than when payment is received or made. This matching simplifies accounting in practice, but conceptually results in some very unintuitive implications for managers. For example, if you outsourced your third-party risk management, TPRM, you may pay an annual subscription fee up front, say on January 1st. However, To consummate the transaction, the partner must deliver the service in full. So, if there was a $120,000 subscription for the year, your expenses may accrue $10,000 per month throughout the year. In this example, you pay the TPRM vendor in January, but the service must be delivered to complete the transaction. Now imagine, in this case, that your TPRM vendor heavily discounted the sale to a point where providing the service was not profitable. On January 1st, you paid the service in full, but the business proceeded to operate unprofitably and your vendor realized a loss by the end of the year. Indeed, cash flow is not profit. You may be wondering, then what good is cash flow and why should we care? Simply stated, it's the inflows and outflows of cash for a business. To operate a business, you have to pay your debts when they come due. If you cannot, you may be declared insolvent. Cash flow and balance sheet insolvency tests are the two ways of determining insolvency. As a cybersecurity leader, managing operating activities is likely the most significant lever you have to impact insolvency. For example, by negotiating extended payables when you contract with third-party providers. There are assuredly prescriptive procurement processes in larger companies that ensure your contracting practices align with company standards. Otherwise, you can try requesting net 45 rather than net 30 in your terms and conditions. That just means payment is due 45 days after the invoice date rather than the typical 30. Everyone recognizes it takes time to make a payment. While that time passes, essentially, one company is financing the amount for the other. Let's be honest. The payment terms on cybersecurity consulting engagements aren't likely to make a sizable difference for the business. But your finance department will at least appreciate awareness of the issue. Also, tactically conceding terms like this helps create reciprocity when negotiating a contract. More on negotiating in Chapter 12, Negotiation. Now, let's briefly contrast insolvency with bankruptcy. An organization may declare bankruptcy if its only option to resolve a distressed financial position cannot be addressed by selling off all assets to clear its total debt. At this point, the courts initiate a legal process to resolve the debt. The court decides how the bankrupt company will repay debts. Debt repayment plans may include selling tangible and intangible assets. While your ability to impact insolvency is low, your ability to protect against bankruptcy is more pronounced. Some examples where cybersecurity failures led directly to bankruptcy include intellectual property loss, Westinghouse Nuclear, Nortel Networks, SolarWorld. Loss of cash resulting from cryptocurrency exchange compromise, Mt. Gox, Ubit. Wire transfer fraud, Little & King, LLC. Lost revenue from contract termination, Altegrity Risk International. Ransomware, Colorado Timberline. Other extortion, Codespace. In many businesses, cash is king. To successfully navigate the political landscape, you must know what figures business managers are looking to optimize either for their benefit or the company as a whole. Next, we'll examine the best resource I know of to empower your understanding of how financial statements impact behaviors and decisions. Connections between the financial statements. How to read a financial report, Ringing Vital Signs Out of the Numbers by John A. Tracy, is one of the most profoundly productive resources presented during my MBA. In particular, he offers an exhibit that provides a visual overview of the connections between the three financial statements. Figure 1.1. Throughout this chapter, I mentioned we would pull together a few concepts in this section, including net income and retained earnings, CapEx and EBITDA, cash and profit. Net income and retained earnings. As you can see in Figure 1.1, the balance sheet features retained earnings. Retained earnings are the cash that a company decides to keep at the end of an accounting period. But notice that in this example, retained earnings are less than net income. Where did the rest of the cash go? Follow the arrows and you quickly discover a cash dividend from profit paid to owners. Retained earnings equals net income minus cash dividend from profit. CapEx and EBITDA. Again, using Figure 1.1, it is easy to connect the relevant elements in the financial statements. In this case, the accumulated depreciation contra account on the balance sheet relates to the depreciation expense on the income statement. Ironically, because depreciation is a non-cash expense, it is added back to the cash flow statement in the operating activities section, alongside other expenses such as amortization. This accounting trick keeps the books balanced, but tends to be conceptually very difficult. The point is only to clarify relationships in the figure. It's worth noting that long-term equity investors will prefer another value, free cash flow, which we will discuss further in Chapter 4, Value Creation. This preference is that EBITDA ignores CapEx, which is an issue to be considered in capital-intensive industries. Cash and profit. Finally, in this example, it's evident that the decrease in cash during year on the statement of cash flows has nothing to do with the net income, bottom line, of the company on the income statement. Tracy dedicates an entire chapter to the impact on growth and decline on cash flow if you're interested in understanding this relationship in more detail. The conclusion I hope you have drawn is that when you are uncertain of the relationship between an action you are taking and a key metric in the business, it's always a good idea to consider this resource as an aid in helping you connect the dots. Application. Imagine there are two CISOs hired at the same time in different companies. They both identify the need to create and operate a threat and vulnerability management TVM program. You estimate the new TVM program will require a vulnerability risk management VRM platform to integrate scanning tools, inventory, asset criticality scoring, software-driven risk analytics, threat feed ingestion, and efficient ticket operations. Case Study 1. Gaming the financial statements. In this first case, a product company has raised capital by selling equity. They are a publicly traded global product manufacturing company, and their new investors believe they can enhance market capitalization by compressing the SG&A costs to optimize profitability while growing revenue through the more efficient deployment of capital in the marketing department. The CISO reports to the CIO. The company believes that higher revenue growth, coupled with stronger EBITDA, will provide the return on investment they need to satisfy their new equity holders. What are the key challenges you see in this situation? What actions might you recommend? In this case, likely the CISO budget primarily comprises SG&A. This account is already a target for cost reduction, so you can anticipate more scrutiny before you begin. Unfortunately, one-size-fits-all targets are all too common when performing cost reduction. Deloitte reports that it is common for companies to tackle SG&A cost reductions by implementing across-the-board cuts without fully understanding the potential impact on their business. A company may use an opportunity assessment and a high-level business case to identify optimal savings and improvements. Targeted restructuring or cost reductions may be better suited to optimize growth strategies. While it's not clear how your company will behave, one approach to consider is to capitalize the program build-out while noting in the future you will eventually need an operational budget to manage and maintain the program. There are accounting rules that guide what can be capitalized, so if there's any confusion, A quick conversation with your accounting team will provide the clarity you need. By capitalizing costs in the first year, you can move the expense from SG&A to a much smaller depreciation expense by spreading the investment over several years. For example, a purchase of $1 million can be expensed equally over 4 years of its useful life, implying an annual expense of $250,000. The yearly impact on EBITDA is only $250,000. Your employer's FP&A can advise you on the threshold over which specific amounts are capitalized, as well as timeframes for useful lives. Case Study 2. Proper team structure and tooling enables value creation. The other business is a professional services firm. The CISO reports up through legal and to the board of directors via the audit committee. The company recently hired a new CTO to transform the business by bringing new digital platforms online to support more efficient operations and innovative new service offerings to customers. The company's focus is on building an agile and more entrepreneurial business by encouraging the rapid adoption of state-of-the-art technologies in the public cloud. Also, the company plans to test and iterate through various technology platforms rapidly. As such, you don't want to make any large investments with significant implementation timelines where incorrect assumptions could lead to poorly tooled security operations. Knowing your company's key financial metrics helps you better structure your budget and potential investments. In this case, the company's focus is on growing revenue and market share. By now, you should be thinking about how the business will consider OPEX. Yes. Your CTO will favor an approach that heavily leans into cloud-native technologies and augments that with additional independent software vendors, ISVs, that play well in a multi-cloud environment. There will be a much larger appetite for you to hire team members with skills that help guide DevOps teams. By collaborating to implement best practices that are architecturally sound and congruent with rapid development, you might even consider placing budget and staff outside the security team directly under the control and supervision of the CTO. Expensive scanning tools that integrate into traditional endpoint and SIEM or SIM solutions might be great for the existing technology stack and security operations. However, be conscious of the need to accommodate new requirements stemming from emerging technologies such as Amazon Machine Images, AMIs, Kubernetes, K8s or Kates, clusters, Docker images, and serverless approaches. Suppose the technology you select and integrate does not have a flexible pricing model. In that case, you might inadvertently commit your mid- to long-term security roadmap to a set of technologies that your company isn't using in a few short months. Instead, consider the following as reported by CSO Online. CISOs could depart for their organizations suffering a damaging breach, but could leave too in the event of failing to spot or report a bug, poor purchasing decisions, or because of disagreements with senior management. One head of information governance, previously working in the U.S. media sector, tells me that there were two occasions she saw her CISO asked to leave. Both dismissals, she said, mostly centered about an inability to address risk to a satisfactory state and in an economical manner. Other sources, speaking to me anonymously, recall occasions where the firm's CISO was dismissed for poor reporting, exceeding their budget, not following business strategies, or even spreading FUD, fear, uncertainty, and doubt, rather than delivering practical solutions to these same problems. It was, as one CIO remarked, a case of the CISO talking the talk, but not walking the walk. Certainly, exceeding budgets, poor purchasing decisions, and impractical solutions likely stem from a poor understanding of the business. So talk to your finance department. No, really. Go send out the invite. Key insights. Align to critical business activities. Depending upon your business model and perhaps the economic sector, there are often compelling arguments that a cybersecurity leader can make about how their team contributes to enhancing revenue acquisition. More sales activity means more revenue to fund operations, including cybersecurity operations. Leverage insights that help you plan your future security program. Third-party risk management, TPRM, gives you a view into revenue sources, what types of customers you will soon serve, and what expectations of value exist. These insights can help you anticipate demands on other areas of your security program. Know which financial metrics derive your company's valuation. Revenue, enterprise value, EBITDA, debt-to-equity, DE ratio, productive asset investment ratio, PER, etc. Understanding the role CapEx plays in your business. A $1 million capital expenditure can be spread over a useful life of 4 years, leading to a run rate of $250,000 per year. Understand how this can impact valuation metrics like EBITDA. Place security champions in other teams to keep your CFO happy, depending upon your business model. Know how cybersecurity failures can lead directly to bankruptcy. Don't commit your mid- to long-term security roadmap to a set of technologies that your company isn't using in a few short months. Chapter 2. Business Strategy Tools. Everything around you that you call life was made up by people that were no smarter than you, and you can change it. You can influence it. Once you learn that, you'll never be the same again. Steve Jobs. Opportunity. Chapter 1 established foundational vocabulary and connected you to the business's scoreboard, the financial statements. The financial statements are how the outside world judges your CEO and board of directors. However, most employees never see complete financial statements. Even in a publicly traded company where the financial statements are readily available for download, you are unlikely to have your manager speak directly to the annual report, much less distribute it for your review. Instead, operators of the business focus on how to create, deliver, and capture value. To ease into the concept of value as a black box, let's begin with an analogy. Shortly after I graduated from college, I accidentally stumbled into a penetration testing role. I loved it. Breaking stuff was fun. A successful penetration, pen tester, must understand foundational technologies to be effective. Without knowledge of how database queries or serialization languages function, a pen tester may fail to identify a bug. Further, without understanding the functional and non-functional requirements of an application, coding defects will likely remain undiscovered. In short, pen testers may emulate specific tactics, techniques, and procedures, TTP, to evaluate an application. Mastery of the pen testing discipline requires that you move beyond guessing what's in the black box. You have to combine TTP and organizational context to thrive. You must understand how your target contributes to the organizational flywheel, and if you can disrupt the flywheel, people care. As a leader, the knowledge you use evolves from technical specifics such as SQL or SQL, XML, and JSON or JSON to business knowledge and influence skill. Mastery of development frameworks, coding methodology, and encoding techniques are no longer the primary predictors of your effectiveness. Instead, your tool belt looks quite different. Most security professionals fail to capture the elusive opportunity to inject security into executive dialogue and decision-making processes. This chapter will review foundational tools that will enable you to decompose any business from several different perspectives. Without the understanding that these tools provide, you are the management equivalent of a script kiddie. That said, reckless application of these tools can be as dangerous as Metasploit in the hands of a teenager. So this chapter will get you pointed in the right direction. Later in Part 2, Communication and Education, and Part 3, Cybersecurity Leadership, we will expand upon the tools covered in this chapter by offering guidance on how to secure budgets, navigate bureaucracies, steer technology decisions, and modify behaviors throughout the business. Principle. The most fundamental goal of any business is to serve its customers profitably. This section will overview essential tools that intimately connect you to the heart of a company. Specifically, you will learn about business models, company performance metrics, value chains, systems theory, and risk-adjusted measurement. These tools will enable you to identify key value drivers, understand which measures likely influence peer behavior, clarify your cybersecurity role in the value chain, avoid pitfalls revealed by system theory, report risk measures in the context of business performance. No doubt, equipped with these requisite tools, your future exploits on the internal battlefield will produce better results. Let's begin with the business model. Business model. The business model describes the rationale of how an organization creates, delivers, and captures value. Meanwhile, the business model canvas, the canvas, offers a shared language for describing, visualizing, assessing, and changing business models. The canvas comprises 9 basic building blocks, including customer segments, value propositions, channels, customer relationships, revenue streams, key resources, key activities, key partnerships, and cost structure. Figure 2.1 presents the canvas visually. As a new or incoming security leader, I suggest building a canvas to solidify your early understanding of the business. Produce the canvas as a formal deliverable of your systematic approach to learning in the first 90 days of employment. Do this business analysis before you get recent audit reports, pen test results, or a systems inventory. Now, if you've been with a company for quite some time, you will also benefit from new insights by completing the mapping exercise. In the application section of this chapter, we will construct a sample canvas and offer a few examples of how the canvas has proven helpful in driving change within a service business. Company performance measures. One cannot deploy security countermeasures successfully while lacking a solid understanding of the business, its risks, and its compliance obligations. After achieving clarity on the business model, the logical next step in understanding how a business derives value for its customers and equity holders is to dissect its key performance indicators, KPIs. In most companies, success or failure depends upon a small set of executive KPIs. This streamlined set of metrics often impacts returns for shareholders and compensation for teams/individuals. Personally, both times that I built and led a security function, the commitment to adding a security leader came immediately following an infusion of capital from a private equity PE transaction. I have learned that it can be beneficial to understand your board's makeup, including those who are independent directors versus controlling shareholders. Understanding board composition is helpful even if you don't interact with the board directly. There are many types of investors. Each investor has a strategy that will guide the types of investments made. Frequently, the investment strategy is derived from a unique ability to enhance the performance of the target investment. For example, PE investors say they place a heavy emphasis on adding value to their portfolio companies, both before and after they invest. The source of that added value, in order of importance, are increasing revenue, improving incentives and governance, facilitating a high-value exit or sale, making additional acquisitions, replacing management, and reducing costs. That is to say, knowing about investors can clarify what types of value creation activities will be most important. The metrics investors commonly care about most include revenue, gross profit, EBITDA, and free cash flow. The relative priority of these metrics will be determined in large part by how investors realize gains. More on this in Chapter 4, Value Creation. Ironically, in high-performing teams, these numbers are not usually the focus of individual managers outside of the executive leadership team. To understand why, we need to discuss lead and lag measures. A lead measure tells you if you are likely to reach the goal, while a lag measure tells you if you've achieved it. All the metrics discussed a moment ago are lag measures. To illustrate, consider W. Edwards Deming's comments that managing a company by looking at financial data, which are lag measures, is like driving a car by looking in the rearview mirror. Considering the lead measures that directly affect the key activities, value propositions, cost structure, and revenue streams is an ideal starting place. Once you are clear about which numbers drive your organization's value, you can begin to connect security using the concept of value chains. Cybersecurity, part of the value chain. For most companies, strategic planning usually starts as a cross-functional off-site exercise for executive teams. Once complete, with organizational targets set, teams break off to organize themselves and execute accordingly. This pattern usually results in cascaded goals, objectives, and measures. Unfortunately, teams optimize within their department, often unaware of the interdependent processes affected by their efforts. As we all know, operating in silos causes many vexing cultural and performance challenges for middle managers in particular. More than 35 years ago, Michael Porter wrote a book titled Competitive Advantage: Creating and Sustaining Superior Performance. In his book, he outlines the generic value chain. Using the value chain model, we can examine the discrete building blocks of competitive advantage. He explains that firm infrastructure consists of many activities, including general management, planning, finance, accounting, legal, government affairs, and quality management. As seen in Figure 2.2, infrastructure, unlike other support activities, usually supports the entire chain and not individual activities. Given this definition, cybersecurity can be considered firm infrastructure in the context of the value chain model. Per Porter's admission, firm infrastructure is sometimes viewed only as overhead, but can be a powerful source of competitive advantage. He goes on to explain, firms have often gained a competitive advantage by redefining the roles of traditional activities. But we're not done with the model yet. We can go beyond the simple rosy statement that cybersecurity teams can add value in unconventional ways. Although value activities are the building blocks of competitive advantage, the value chain is not a collection of independent activities, but a system of interdependent activities. Linkages within the value chain relate value activities. Linkages are relationships between the way one value activity is performed and the cost or performance of another. Competitive advantage frequently derives from linkages among activities, just as it does from the individual activities themselves. Though linkages within the value chain are crucial to competitive advantage, they are often subtle and go unrecognized. Indeed, exploiting linkages also frequently requires optimization or coordination that cuts across conventional organizational lines. And finally, we observe that, given the difficulty of recognizing and managing linkages, the ability to do so often yields a sustainable source of competitive advantage. Porter explains that there are two basic types of competitive advantage: cost leadership and differentiation. Considering his model from the vantage point of cybersecurity yields critical and empowering insights. There is ample room for a company to leverage cybersecurity as a competitive advantage. A cybersecurity team's unique position and skill permit it to identify what Porter terms proprietary learning, a primary source of sustainable differentiation. While other parts of a company have a cross-functional supporting role, Most of these functions, such as finance, legal, and quality, lack the technical expertise or technology operations intimacy to offer the insights cybersecurity teams naturally surface. These insights are increasingly valuable in the age of digital transformation. If this is all true, what should we as security practitioners be looking for, given our unique vantage point? Linkages can lead to competitive advantage in two ways: optimization and coordination. To begin with, we can start inside our teams. We can model the changes we hope to observe in our broader organization, not by optimizing our own performance alone, but instead by serving as a supporting function designed to create competitive advantages for the firm. Malcolm Harkins got it right when he said, "Security teams need to be the risk takers, to be at the forefront so they can shape the path. Manage the risk instead of being the ones always saying no. If you're the one experimenting with it, you can be the one to figure out how to manage the risk before everybody else gets there. Further, you have to show how, as technology spending grows, you're going to ask for a smaller percentage of that spend, with lower friction on the business and the user experience with lower liability." In the application section, we'll review an example of optimization and another of coordination. Apply systems theory to avoid the trap. There is an increasing focus on security performance management, SPM. This trend, no doubt, correlates with business leaders allocating material budgets to security teams, in addition to pervasive cybersecurity board reporting. As with any new term, SPM means different things to different people. For our purposes, I reference SPM only to highlight cybersecurity teams are beginning to optimize in various ways. But don't fall for the trap. As we just discussed, it is common for business leaders to optimize the performance of their teams' processes. All too often, we see security teams working hard to optimize security operations or security engineering processes. In contrast, the real target should be to maximize business performance as a whole. Stated differently, optimize the system. Why is the distinction between system and process so important? The answer lies in one of the fundamental assumptions of systems theory. The whole is not equal to the sum of its parts. The assumption that it is originates in a fundamental algebraic axiom. Unfortunately, however, complex systems are anything but mathematically precise. The improper allocation of the algebraic axiom to the management of organization would sound like this. If we break down our system into its components, maximize the efficiency of each one, then reassemble the parts, we'll have the most efficient systems. It's been said that elegant theories are often slain by ugly, inconvenient facts. That's the case here. The mathematical or analytical approach to system improvement is one of those victims. It's also been said that the...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.